Good morning. Welcome to our 11 o'clock worship service. And whether you're here in person or you're watching online, we're glad you're with us this morning. Also, we want to just say a big, big thank you. We had our fall festival here yesterday, and we had over 1,200 people that showed up for our fall festival, including that, absolutely. Included in that 1,200 was 100 of our, over 100 of our church people that volunteered their time to help out with the Fall Festival. I think it's the most we've ever had help out for a Fall Festival. We want to thank you so much for spending your day here and doing your part to help out with the Fall Festival. We handed out over, we handed out 133 cakes yesterday. So you guys did a great job of bringing those cakes in, and the people had a fun time winning those cakes, and so it was fantastic. So we appreciate everybody's help in doing everything yesterday. I think over 800 hot dogs or something like that. Is that the number? Yeah. So it was a good, fun day. So if you're here for the first time because of Fall Festival, or if you're just new with us in general, we want you to know a few things that's going to happen in our service this morning. We are going to take communion here in just a few moments, and so if you didn't get that little prepackaged communion on your way in, there's some on the back wall over here on my right, your left. You can grab that while we're singing our songs this morning as we prepare for communion. If you'd like to give this morning, there's a couple donation stations out in our cafe, and we appreciate those gifts. It does help us to continue God's work here in Port Orange and around the world through our missions program. 11% of what you give goes straight to our missions program, so you're impacting people all around the world with your gifts this morning, so we thank you for that. Also, in the seat back pocket in front of you should be a Connect card. And if you'll take a moment, especially our first and second time guests, if you'll take a moment to fill that out, hold on to that card. And when you leave out here later this morning, and when you go by the information booth that you passed on your way in, just drop that card off there. And we'd like to give you a gift as a thank you for being with us this morning. And we encourage anybody to fill that card out as well. If there's things, prayer requests or emails or phone numbers or addresses or anything you want to update us on so that we can stay in contact with you the best way we can. Also, you can put just a general comment in there if you'd like, and you can turn that into the same place at the information booth when you head out later this morning. So we're going to pray, and then we're going to jump into our time of music this morning. God, we love you. We come before you now, and we thank you so much for what you've already done in this house of worship this morning. God, again, for this service, we pray that you send your Holy Spirit into this place this morning. Move around like you've never moved before. And if there are people here today, God, that are right there, they're ready to make that decision, we pray that you will move them past the mark today, that they will hear something, that they will feel something, that they'll feel your Spirit moving in their lives today, that they will want to accept you into their lives for the first time. God, we pray that our baptistry will be busy today and every day. God, we pray that we can bring more people into the fold each and every day with your powerful gospel message. God, we pray you be with us now as we sing your praises, as we lift your name on high, and we hear your message. We pray you be with Tom this morning as he brings the message. God, we pray you be with us as we commune with you and we give back to you the children's ministry and everything else that's going on in the life of this church this morning, that we will know more about you when we leave than when we got here today. God, we love you. We praise you. We pray all these things in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand as we sing songs of praise this morning.
Come and be healed.
revival come. Let the people see the glory of your name. Let revival come. Let the people see the glory of your name. Let's sing that this morning. Let revival come.
Let revival come. Let the people see the glory of your name. Let revival come. Let the people see the glory of your name. The glory of your name.
So good. the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. Oh, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath
you told me the life may not be easy, and everything that I need you've already given me. I remember how you told me I can trust you completely. So why am I when you prove that you fight for me? You've walked me through fire, pulled me from flames. If you're in this with me, I won't be afraid. When the smoke billows higher, oh, and higher, it feels like I can barely breathe. I walk to these fires, 'cause you're walking with me. I'm changed by your mercy, you're covered by your peace. Living out the victory doesn't mean I won't feel the heat. I'll walk me through fire, pull me from flames. If you're in this with me, I won't be afraid. Smoke billows higher, oh, and higher. It feels like I can barely breathe. Walk to these fires, 'cause you're walking in me. I can face anything, 'cause you're here. Of my redemption, Lord, how could I question when you proved that you died for me? You walked me through fire, pulled me from flames. If you're in this with me, the smoke billows higher, oh, and higher. It feels like I can barely breathe. I walk to these fires, 'cause you're walking in me. I walk to these fires, 'cause you're walking in me.
Types of fathers, personality-wise. Either one, when you fall and you get hurt, you have a father that's going to come and comfort you, and he's going to pick you up, wipe off your knee, and say, it's okay. and send you on your way. Or you have the other type of father, which I hit home with this one. You fall, you get hurt, and he says a phrase to you, says, if you're going to be dumb, you better be tough. I heard that a lot in my life because I did a lot of dumb things. But I think the song we just sang, in a time where we come to hear, thinking about the things we've done, the things that our Heavenly Father has done for us, the song hits perfectly. Because we see both types of Heavenly Father in that song. We see the Father says, look, grab my hand and I'm going to pull you through the flames. And the other one that says, it's okay, get up and keep on moving. And it's amazing when we come to this time where the song even said, you can't doubt your Heavenly Father because he's already died for you. He's already sent his son to die on the cross so that we can enter this relationship. We can enter this time where we don't have to worry about where you're going once you're done here. You know where you're going. You know the place that God has already prepared for us, and he's going to be that Heavenly Father who's going to say, hey, look, grab my hand. It's out whenever you want it. You just got to take it, and we're going to go through life together. And even in those times, he's still going to say, look, you got yourself in this rough position. It's going to hurt, but I'm not leaving you. And it's amazing that we get to say that. We get to say we have a father who didn't have to do something to create a relationship with us. He didn't have to repair the bridge so that we could enter into his presence, but he did. He created something and he did something where we can say, I messed up, I've done wrong, but I understand where I need to go from here. So Lord, I just want to first say thank you from the bottom of my heart and everybody's heart to hear that. Thank you for being a father who wants a relationship with us, who wants for us to enter his presence every single day for the rest of eternity. Please just as this time where we take this bread and we take this juice, just let us be thankful for that. Remember that no matter what we go through in life, no matter what trials or hardships are coming our way, you're standing next to us saying, just grab my hand and we're going to get through this together. And just let that hit home and let that change hearts and how we deal with stuff in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's so good to see everybody this morning, and I just want to thank you for yesterday, all your work and
effort, and that was an awesome day, and many of you made such great contributions of work and time and energy to just come together as a church and to love our community. I am proud of you as a church, and I'm so excited by what God has done in our church this weekend. Man, fantastic. Appreciate it. Yeah, it was a great day. All right, so we are in John chapter 4, and we just, you know, kind of talked about the woman at the well last week, and Jesus was in Samaria, which is not some place that the disciples really wanted to be. They're Jewish, and they don't like Samaritans. They look down their nose at them, and there's a lot of reasons why they don't get along. And not only did Jesus, you know, stay in Samaria and teach these people, but the Bible says he stayed there 2 days, which is probably 2 days longer than the disciples wanted to be there. But the people believed. You know, they couldn't help but be moved by this woman's testimony. And then as they listened to Jesus himself teach, it says many of them came to believe because they'd heard for themselves that Jesus, and they really believed he's the Savior of the world. And then the very next verse indicates that, you know, as they're leaving Samaria and going back, resuming their trip up north to Galilee and Cana, there's this little comment where Jesus says, you know, guys, a prophet's never welcome in his own hometown. And what he means by that is, you remember when we were in Jerusalem? You know, that's the center of the religious life. I mean, I should be celebrated in Jerusalem. But remember the interaction in Jerusalem? It was driving out the money changers and the whip, and there was a lot of problems and chaos. And he's saying, you know, I go to Samaria, and look at how we're received by the Samaritans. They loved us, and they honored me. And, you know, I wish we could get that kind of reception among our own people. But you remember how John starts, as he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. But to all those who do receive him, he gives the right to become children of God, including Samaritans. So they resume their journey back up north into Galilee, into the hill country where the country folks live. This is Jesus, you know, where he grew up. It's very familiar to him. And when he comes into Galilee, it says as he arrives, you know, the Galileans welcomed him. Now, remember, the last time he was there, he turned water into wine. So, you know, that's going to make you popular among some people just because you did a miracle. If you did one miracle, what else can you do? That was awesome. Remember when you were here and you turned the water into wine? Could you make fire come out of a tree? You know, I mean, it'd be great to see what could you possibly do. And so the Galileans, they talk. Word gets out. And so when he comes back into town, I imagine there's a big crowd that wants to be around him and see what else he's going to do. And so the people rush in, they come around him, and they also, many of them had been to Jerusalem, and they saw him in his interactions with the temple, with the religious leaders, and they're proud of him. I've said before, you know, can you imagine if some of you guys might go to Congress and just start punching noses? There'd probably be a lot of Americans that'd be like, yeah, finally, you know, those people that think they're in charge. They ruin our lives and mess up our country, and now we're giving it back to them. And so people were thrilled with Jesus at this point in his ministry. And they're gathering around to see what he can do. Now it says, as he's in Galilee, verse 46, he says, a certain royal official whose son lay sick at Capernaum, and this royal official is probably in Herod's court. He's a man of honor, a man of position. He has a son who's dying in the city of Capernaum. That's where he's from. And it says, when this man heard that Jesus had arrived in Galilee from Judea, he went to him and begged him to come and heal his son who was close to death. Unless you people see signs and wonders, Jesus told him, you will never believe. The royal official said, sir, come down before my child dies. Go, Jesus replied, your son will live. The man took Jesus at his word and departed. And while he was still on the way, his servants met him with the news that his boy was living. When he inquired as to the time when his son got better, they said to him, yesterday at 1 PM, the fever left him. The father realized that was the exact time that Jesus had said to him, your son will live. So he and his whole household believed. That was the second sign that Jesus performed after coming from Judea to Galilee. All right, I want to kind of get into this mindset of this man, you know, what's going on in his life. I want you to see that he's a desperate person who doesn't have any more options, which is not usual, the custom for this kind of a person. I mean, remember, he's a royal official. Now, I was talking about politics a little bit. Let me talk a little bit more about it. You know, we kind of understand, or at least some people think, that in the country today, there's maybe two kinds of rules. You know, there's the rules for the people that write the laws and, you know, have the power and the position, and then there's the rules that the rest of us have to live by, right? Sometimes you kind of see this, like, oh, they're able to talk their way out of crimes and out of jail, and, you know, and imagine if this guy has this royal position, he's used to being able to, like, turn the dials of life to make stuff happen, even for himself. That's the way it works. When you have a position of power, people often use their position of power. That's why they often end up in those positions. And so when you have a sick child at home, you know, people with power, they're able to just kind of get their needs to the front of the line. And so I know the doctors are booked up. I know that they said they don't have any more appointments. But, you know, whose son is this? Okay, well, we'll make an exception. I think we could see him on this day. And so they're able to manipulate things to get their needs met. But here's the problem is nothing's worked. If anything else would have worked, there wouldn't be a problem. It would already be taken care of. But this boy is dying. I don't know what the condition is, but he's sick and dying, and he's in his last days of life. And I imagine they'd been to every resource that they knew to go to. I mean, this guy is a person who's used to getting things done, and he can't fix this problem. You know, there will be problems in your life that you will face that you just cannot fix. You can't change it. If you could change it, you would, but you can't change it. And so sometimes these problems that we go through in life are beyond our ability to remedy. And so I imagine he's probably taken him to doctors. He's probably taken him to maybe even religious leaders, and they've anointed with oil and they've prayed over him, and nothing's working. He's watching his son, his heir, collapse. And you know, his future is dying in front of him. Because there's a good chance that one day when he decides to retire, his son would maybe take that position, because that's sometimes how it works in powerful families. But instead of envisioning this bright future, which you all do, I mean, we all envision this wonderful future for what our kids' life might be like. You know, I'm thrilled to see so many new babies born in our church, and some of you young families, it's awesome to watch you, because my wife and I were there many years ago. But you know, when you bring that first baby home from the hospital, hopefully it's yours, but when you don't get to choose, you got to take the one that belongs to you, you know? And so you bring this baby home, and you're like, oh, this is so wonderful. How could anybody ever hurt something like this? This is great, you know? But then what happens? Well, after about a month or two or maybe three, they're going to get sick. And when they get sick, it's terrifying, because you've never had to deal with this before. You know what it's like to be sick, and you're pretty confident that you'll recover. But then when you're holding this little child, you're like, I can't break them. I'll get in trouble if I let something happen to this kid. Look, they got a rash now. Mom, what do I do? And you get on the phone and you call your parents or you call your neighbor and you tell them the symptoms. And should I rush them right now to the emergency room? Should I call an ambulance? What should I do? They won't go to sleep. Or they just got this terrible fever. It's terrifying. And it can be exhausting. But, you know, they get better. Maybe they have to take an antibiotic. Maybe they see a doctor, and the doctor looks at them and goes, oh, well, yeah, you know, we're not worried about this. Everything seems to be okay. And okay, well, if the doctor says it's okay, then I guess it's going to be okay. If mom knows what this is, then I'm not going to worry about it, but I hope it's going to be all right. But then what if it's not all right? I mean, what if you see your child really declining? Here they are, 14, 15 years old, and you're watching them, you know, just lay on a couch. and you think, I don't know what else to do. I mean, I've done everything. We take them to the doctor. We went to the hospital. We took them to the hospital, and they just said, well, there's nothing else we can do for you now. We're just going to have to try to make you comfortable. I think you need to accept the reality that the future, you know, your life is just going to... And you think, what? How did this happen? What do I do? Who do I call? Where do I go now? I would do anything. What do I have to do to try to make help this child? And they're not getting better. They're getting worse. And you think back to all those birthday parties and all those, you know, school parties, and you remember your kid running out there in the yard and playing and having a great time and all these wishes and hopes and dreams for their future, but they're not getting better. They're getting worse. And you have to watch your child decline on the verge of teetering with death. And that's not the way it's supposed to happen, you know? I mean, it's hard enough to bury your father. You see this person that's strong and powerful and is able to come through all the time and take care of things, and then you're standing one day next to the casket, and you look down and you go, how is that my dad there? But as hard as that is, I mean, some of you guys can imagine what it's like when it's reversed and you're looking at your son or your daughter in a casket. I mean, I remember yesterday somebody asked me, Tom, how do we know the will of God for our lives? And I was like, well, wow. You know, there's kind of a short answer and a long answer. And they were like, well, what's the long answer? I was like, the long answer is, I don't know. It's really hard. You got to try to figure it out. You read the Bible and you look for verses and you try to find a verse that gives you some sense of peace. Like, okay, well, I read this verse and now I feel like there's this peace that it's okay for me to do. I'm not contradicting any scripture. So I just feel like, you know, I have this peace about doing it. And it's hard to figure that out sometimes. Then he was like, well, what's the simple answer? The simple answer is the Garden of Eden. Do you remember the Garden of Eden? That was God's will. And in the Garden of Eden, the way things were supposed to be, you don't have kids sick, dying with fevers. There's nothing to be angry about because everything is as it should be. There's nothing to be afraid of because our lives are protected in the garden. And we're not questioning our worth and value because we're walking with the Lord. But we don't live in the Garden of Eden any longer. And people get sick and people die. And sometimes you face hopeless situations. And it can be terrifying and exhausting. And I can't imagine what the conversation's like at the home. Because, you know, maybe the wife, maybe the mom is saying to him as he's watching his son die in tears. Maybe he can't cry anymore. He's just, what do I do? And his wife says, you know, there's that religious guy. They're talking about him in Cana. He like turned water to wine or something. I mean, maybe he could help. Well, you know, we've already been to the religious leaders and they couldn't help. No, this guy's different. They were just talking about him in the marketplace. You should go. You got to do something. We can't sit here and watch our son die. You have to go. Or maybe it was the other way around. Maybe he was wanting to go. I should go. I should do something. It's 20 miles. If I leave, what if he dies while I'm gone? I need to be here with my son, but I've got to go. And maybe his wife is the other voice saying, you can't leave us. You can't leave me alone. What if something happens? I can't go through this by myself. I need you here. Your son needs you. Don't leave. Stay here with us. I got to go. There's a chance. If there's any chance at all, I have to go see. What's that 20-mile walk feel like? You're torn between two places. I want to be with my son who needs me, but I've got to go for the chance that maybe some miracle can happen. I imagine there's tears, there's wondering, there's questioning, there's begging with God. Please, Lord, you've got to come through for me. He has to come home with me. I'm not gonna settle for asking him. He must come home with me. I will not lose my son without doing everything I can do. Remember, this man's an official. He makes things happen, and sometimes officials can arrest people if they need to. Perhaps he has a dagger on his side. I will force him to come home with me. He will not say no to me because he has a limiting belief, and that limiting belief is the only way his son can be healed by a miracle is if the miracle worker is present. There's too much distance. It's 20 miles distance. And what if I come back home and I don't have the miracle worker with me? How will I face my family then? They'll say, see, we told you. You should have stayed here. And now he's gone and you weren't here. And what if the miracle worker comes and tries and the incantation, the potion, the words, it doesn't work the first time. I need him here so that he can do something else. That didn't work. Do it again. Do it different. I can't let him not come home. I want you to see that all of Galilee is celebrating. Hey, the miracle worker's back. Everybody's rejoicing. Everybody's smiling. Everybody's saying, come eat with us. Come to our house. One man in the middle of that group is not celebrating. He's not rejoicing. He is on a mission. He is intent. He is focused. Tear-stained eyes. He is headed for one person, and he doesn't want to talk to anybody else. There will be times in your life when you come to church and everybody is celebrating and singing and laughing, and they're over in corners talking about the football game. They're talking about the retreat. It just seems like they have so much to worship for, so much to celebrate, and you just can't because of what's waiting for you back home. And you're thinking to yourself, I can't be bothered with all of this right now. I have to find the Savior. I have to find the Lord. And people will say, are you okay? Are you all right? Is there something wrong? No, I'm not okay. I'm not all right. This man has enough. I want you to see his journey of faith, okay? Because it is a journey. He has enough faith to risk leaving the bedside of his dying son with the hope that maybe God can solve this problem for him. So by faith, he takes the 20-mile walk, not knowing what's happening back home, with the hope that maybe the Savior will hear him and respond. He went to Jesus, and what does it say? He begged him. He's a royal official. He's used to people begging him. Hey, do you think you could move our paperwork ahead? I mean, here's a couple hundred dollars. If you can you make that work out? Hey, do you think you could talk to the judge and see if you can get some kind of leniency on this over here? Because here's a couple hundred dollars. He's used to people begging his time, begging his resources, begging his attention. But look what happens. You know what happens? Life, problems, pain, crisis, life outside the garden, you know what it does? It reduces us down to help us to see what we actually are. Beggars, every one of us. The titles that he holds don't mean anything. It won't help his child. The office he has, the salary he has, the notoriety he has, that's all great. He's enjoyed it, but it won't fix the problem. He finds himself begging, please. No one else, he's not focused on anybody else. He's not paying attention to anyone else. They're thinking, isn't that the guy that... He's not focused on any of that. He's begging Jesus. Watch what he says. Come. Come heal my son who was close to death. Now, Jesus says something interesting here. He says, oh, unless you people see signs and miracles, you'll never believe. I don't think Jesus is saying that to the man about the man. I think he's saying it to the crowd about the man. I think what he's saying is I come to Galilee and you guys basically approach me like this. Do something awesome and we'll believe. I mean, you know, come on, make it rain. That'd be great. Can you do that? If you could do that, then we would believe. You know, you did the water wine thing. What else could you do? Show yourself and make yourself real to us, and then we will believe. Look at the example of this man. He doesn't yet see the miracle, but he believes. And he's moving in faith, even though he hasn't seen the miracle. What's the miracle he wants? Heal my child. But even before the miracle happens, he's coming in faith. I think what Jesus is saying is look at this guy. How come you guys aren't more like this guy? He believes enough to come here, whether or not the miracle will ever happen, he comes in faith. You guys ought to take a lesson like that. You guys should learn from this. You won't believe unless you see the miracle. He believes before the miracle happens. Now, his faith is mustard seed, right? It's enough to move him to Jesus, but watch what Jesus does here. You think you have faith now? Let's see how strong your faith really is. Turn around, go back home, trust me, your son will live. Now this man is faced with a dilemma. What do I do now? If I go back home, I don't have him with me. I have to believe that what he said really is going to happen, but I can't prove it. I don't have any evidence. I can't call home. Hey, Jesus said that he's going to be fine. Is he okay? He doesn't know. So he's got to go home 20 miles. What if he walks in the door and his son is not better? Where's the teacher? Where's the rabbi? You said you were going to bring him home. What did you even do? Where were you? We needed you. So now he has to really believe. The Bible says that he did something that is so hard for every one of us to do. He took Jesus at his word. And he turned around and he acted. He prayed, he believed, and he acted. And so we say, yeah, I believe what Jesus says. He says, do not worry. Don't be like, you know, they said the birds of the air, they don't worry. God feeds them, and the flowers, they don't worry, and yet they're more beautiful than all of Solomon's clothes. And yeah, we shouldn't worry. And then what? Something happens. You get a phone call. The principal wants to meet with you and your child. And what happens? You start to worry. Or your child gets sick and the fever gets worse and the medicines aren't working. And we got to do some biopsies and we got to do some tests. And now you're in the hospital or you're at the police station and your son is on the other side of the wall. And what happens? You worry. Oh, I believe what Jesus says, do not worry. But what then? Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. That's a great sermon. That's a great Bible verse. I believe that. And then tragedy. Oh yeah, we're going to have to lay off some jobs. You're going to have to maybe be relocated. And what happens? Worry. Or your daughter brings home a boyfriend. Worry. Right? I believe that. Forgive 7 times 70. Yeah, forgive. We should forgive. It feels great to be forgiven. I know what it's like to mess up, and it was great to be forgiven. I have to forgive them? I have to forgive? Why should I forgive them? I believe what Jesus says, but will you take him at his word? Be content with what you have. I believe him. Will you take him at his word? And then he departs. Now watch. Now he's got this long road back home. And there's a part of him that I think wants to run home. And then another part that isn't sure he wants to go home at all. He's got to go by faith. Every step. I don't have him. What if it doesn't work? What if he's not well? What am I supposed to say? God, please. He's not yet ready to celebrate. Because he's still in the midst of the test. You know, your faith and mine, it's not strengthened. The nature of our faith, the strength of our faith is not revealed by what God can get us out of, but by what God helps us to go through. And he says, while he's still on the way home, some of his servants... Maybe he's 10 miles into the journey, maybe he's 5 miles, maybe he's 15 miles into the journey. But he sees 4 or 5 of his servants coming over the hill, and when they recognize each other, they hit each other and they run toward him. They say, your son's alive. He's okay. He rose up. He the fever left him. He ate something. We saw him. We sat at the table and ate it. He went out and cut the grass. He's doing fine. And I can just see the tears coming in the man's eyes. He says, when did this happen? What time was it? Well, it was 1 o'clock. That's the exact moment that he told me he was going to be fine. He told me only God could do that. You know, this man had this limiting belief that there was too much distance for Jesus to do the miracle. And I wonder today how many of us might feel the same, like, oh, there's so much distance between me and God. Could he really reach down into my life? There's been so many things that have happened. There's been so many compromises and so much time, so much distance between my child and my God. Could God ever span that distance? But Jesus is not limited by the distance. And he breaks through the distance, just his word, and the son is healed. The father realized that was the exact time Jesus had said to him, your son will live. Now watch this. He runs in. I can just imagine him coming in and finding his son, grabbing him, hugging him, and feeling once again the strength in his son's arms. And his son is warm, but not hot. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. I don't understand how it happened. It doesn't make sense to me. But I will receive this blessing. I will receive this miracle. Thank you, Lord, for giving me my son back. No doctor could do it. I was almost making appointments with an undertaker. I had no other options. And the Lord came through and brought Eden back to me. Look what it says. He and his whole household believed. Now, wait a minute. He already believed, didn't he? I mean, he already believed. That's why he left. Remember, he was there next to his son. He was thinking the worst, but then he had this spark of faith and this little bit of hope and a little bit of belief, and he acted on that belief. He believed. He believed so much that I think Jesus praised him in front of the crowds and said, you guys ought to believe like he does. Watch him learn to believe even more. And he turned him around and he said, go. And all the way back, he was believing. It was hard to believe, just like it's hard for you to believe. I'm going to heaven when I die? How do I know for sure? I mean, look at all the things I did. How do I know for sure that when I die, I'm going to heaven? Oh, his word told me. I have to accept that by faith, and I have to walk the rest of this journey believing that one day I will step into his arms. I don't know, except he's given me his word. But I want you to see that his faith grew at every point, and now, what's his faith like now? He knows. This isn't the kind of belief like, maybe, possibly, I think there's a chance. That's what he started with. The faith he has now is, no one could ever tell me what didn't happen. I know what happened. I was there. I remember. I lived it. And I know what the Savior said. And I know what happened. I know how far my son had gone. And it was at the exact moment. I can't explain to you, but I know, my family knows, and I'll stand before the firing squad. I can't deny the truth. Put me in the fire. Throw me to the lions. I can't deny what God has done. I can't believe a lie. This is what happened. There's confidence now. There's assurance now. See, we all want that confidence of faith, but I want you to see the confidence doesn't come without testing. He was tested. Through this whole ordeal, he was tested. He wouldn't have chosen it. He wouldn't have picked it. He didn't want to go through it. But the celebration, that happens now. Now he joins the other believers in Galilee celebrating. Now he's one of the ones standing over in the corner, smiling, laughing, hugging, holding, looking for who's running in that needs the Lord today. You know, something interesting about this passage, another thing comes to mind, is the son never asked to be healed. Someone on his behalf was interceding for him. Are there people in our lives today that either won't or don't know that they should? They don't realize their condition. is there any of us that will go to the Savior on their behalf and intercede for them? Father, we thank you, Lord, for your grace and your goodness. We thank you for your love and mercy. We pray today that you would help us, God, to have the faith that we see demonstrated before us. When we are in the valleys, when we are in the shadows, when we're in the storm, when we've exhausted every other option, and we have nothing that we can say or do except to beg, hear our prayer, God, and like this man said, come home with me. I wonder how different your lives would be today, how different your families would be today if you just said those same words that man said. Just, Lord, come home with me. I don't want to leave you at church. Come home to my family. Come home to my finances. Come home in marriage. Come home with me and go to work with me. It's one thing to be around all of the celebration. It's another to recognize your desperation. Lord, we come to you asking for healing, asking for wholeness, asking for restoration. We pray that you would hear our prayer today, that you would do what only you can do. Be a miracle-working God in our life. And let this church shine your light into this community. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And maybe that person is you today. Maybe someone has interceded for you, or maybe God's putting that call on your heart today to make a decision for Him. If you're watching online this morning, we want to talk to you. We don't want this story to end right here at the end of this video. We want to be able to talk with you. Please reach out to us. Please call us. Please email us. We want to talk to you and pray with you about your decision. If you want to make a decision right here in this room this morning, Tom's waiting with members of our care and prayer team at our decision and prayer rooms. If you're unfamiliar with where those are located, when you go out these doors, your first two rooms on your right, they're ready to talk to you while we sing this song or at any other time this morning. If you just want to stay where you are, you want to pour your heart out in front of God, you want to talk to one of us after the service this morning, please do that today. And we pray that God is moving in your life this morning. Let's go ahead and stand now as we sing our song of invitation.
I want to know you more.
rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Like a
guys so much for joining us with worship this morning. A couple quick things before you go. One is we still need PB&J supplies, tablecloths, things like that, and the PB&J. Also, any shoes that you have, any sizes at all that you could donate, and socks for that, if you'll just drop off at the information booth. Also coming up November the 7th is going to be a mission trip to Louisiana for hurricane relief. So if anyone's interested in that, or knowing more information, you can sign up for that at the info booth also. A couple of things I want to clarify really quick is both of them are concerned with Thanksgiving. We have two different things going on this year. First off is going to be the meal deal. What that is some of the people in our community that we've come in contact with cannot take care of having a Thanksgiving meal. So this year, we as a church, I've got a goal of 50 bags that I want to put together, and these bags are about $30 to $35. We're asking that you guys donate. Everything will look identical. Everything will look the same. It'll be in a Port Orange bag. They'll have a gift certificate that they can get a turkey from Publix at. But so that it allows these families to truly have a family Thanksgiving meal together. So this is a new thing that we've done. So again, it's providing for the community on that. And then secondly is our community meal that we do here at the church on Thanksgiving Day that we want to invite you guys to. It is going to be inviting the community in, but also here for us. The food is actually taken care of this year. Starting next week, we're going to start doing signups for volunteers. So people to serve, people to help set up, clean up, take care, and most importantly, just welcome people into the church. This whole thing is about us being able to give back to the community because God has blessed us so much as a church and as individuals. So that's kind of two different things that are going on this year. So we'd love to have you guys to be involved in that. If you have any questions, let me know. I'll be glad to answer those. But to close out with, I want to tell you from myself, from Jimmy, from Tom, from the elders, from Ellie. It is an honor to serve at this church, to serve at this church with you guys being family. So thank you for just your love, your generosity, for serving at the Community Fall Festival yesterday, all the setup. We about had one little issue. Zach and Alex and Ashley helped diffuse that of a kid getting ran over. So it's always a good event when you don't have a kid ran over. It is a true honor to be a part of your family. So allow me from the bottom of my heart to say thank you for letting me be a part of your family and showing you guys show me every single day, God, your love for God and just your ministry that he's put on your heart. So thank you for that. Let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Father, we love you. We praise you for being the God and King that you are. Father, we praise you for touching each of our lives and allowing our actions and allowing the things that we do to reflect you. Father, I praise you and say thank you so much for this worship band this morning that's brought us into your presence, that's brought us closer to you. And Father, we praise you and thank you that Tom has opened our hearts and opened our minds by your word of seeing what this man has done in just a crisis time of his life. But Father, I ask as we leave this place today that we have the faith of this Father. We have the confidence of this Father that we seek you with everything that we have. And when you say go, we go. Lord, we love you as a family. We love you as a unity and a unified body in your name. Keep us safe until we come back to worship again. Let us go into this mission field to truly worship, to serve, and to give you all the glory. And all of God's people said, amen. Have a wonderful week. Love you guys so much.